Go.
Good evening, and I'd like to welcome everybody to the College of Complexes tonight. My name is Tim, I'm going to be one of the speakers tonight. But before we get into our role as moderator, I would like to first announce what the college is. We are a weekly free speech forum that consists of three parts. There will be a brief announcements period, then there will be a main presentation, and there will be a question and answer period, and then a rebuttal period. We ask during the questions period that you ask a question and an answer, and during the rebuttal period that you get your chance to say your two cents or two bits, whatever you want on it.
We have Tim Bolger, who not only records our meeting, but times them, and Paul Rescino, who does just about everything when he's here, but he can't be here all the time, and we miss him. So they are both very connected people. That is, they're connected by the internet. And they're going to tell us all about it and how, if you pick up the phone or get on the line, you're probably being heard somewhere. Isn't that about right?
That's about right.
Okay. Keep your eyes on the screen there. You'll get lots of information that way. And maybe you'll know how to avoid being overheard.
My name is Tim, and this is going to be a two-part presentation tonight. Paul will be speaking first on some subject matter, then they'll transition over into me, and then we'll finish up and both of us will take questions. I'd like to again thank Paul's daughter, Caitlin Rescino, for helping her run the camera tonight. Caitlin, can you get your hand up real quick? Let's welcome Paul to the speaking position.
Thank you, Tim. As Tim said, we're both going to be speaking tonight. I'm going to talk about a little more technical aspects of the security and things, and Tim's going to give a little more practical on the same subjects. We made up a little agenda. I'm going to talk a little bit about email security. I've talked about that here before, but I just want to go over a couple things, some new things. I'm going to talk about the cloud. I'm sure a lot of you heard about the cloud and may be wondering what it is, and I'll tell you why I think it's evil. And then there's the Internet of Things. If you have a smartphone, a tablet, or anything, your house, your car, or anything connected to the Internet, that's considered the Internet of Things. I'm going to give a little technical background on it, and Tim's going to give a little more practical in his speech. And then Tim's going to go into data breach, some personal experiences he's had, and then the connected web. Email has been around in World Wide Web terms almost forever. It was developed back in the 90s, and email has become an integral part of our society, and anything that has become that integral, of course, is going to be abused. What are the problems? People send many, many, many fake emails. I currently get 500 to 700 a day.
Oh, my God.
And with Christmas, it's even more now because there's a bunch of new ones.
Are you sure it's not spam?
That's what I mean by spam. I get spam 500 to 700 messages that are filtered out every day. How do you know what's good and what's not good? No major corporation or the United States government is going to send you anything unless you ask for it. Ask them to. Microsoft is not going to send you an email or call you on the phone and tell you there's something wrong with your computer unless you're paying them a lot of money. That's a new scam too. Someone calling and saying they're from Microsoft. Oh, we found something wrong with your computer. Don't believe it.
That's right.
because there's no way they can get in without your permission.
That's right.
Or, well, no way easy. The government, I always like, I got a couple emails one time. The FBI wants to see you. If the FBI or the CIA or the I wanted to see me, the men in black would be knocking at my door. If the IRS wanted to talk to you, they'd be calling you on the phone or sending you a letter. I've gotten both of those from the IRS. Do not trust anything from a company or a person you don't know. If you signed up for an email list with a company, well, you're safe. If something comes out of the blue from a place you've never heard of before, don't believe it. If you come up with, if it shows a receive date that is in the future or in the past, I actually had one email, and it pops up in every now and again, from 1969. There was no email in 1969. There was no World Wide Web in 1969. So obviously, it's not good. A little common sense will keep you safe with your emails. What can you do to be careful? If you doubt the email at all, don't click any links.
Yeah.
Open your browser, type in the link, because there can be, links can be faked, links can be forwarded. You go to the actual website, like if they're claiming to be from your bank, you go to your bank's website and do it from there. That's the best way. Just because it says www.chase.com doesn't mean it's going there. Believe me, many of these things can be fake. You need to train whatever software you use to filter out the garbage. Any software, be it online or loaded on your computer, will have a click somewhere for defining mail as either spam or junk. When you click on a message, it's that sender goes on to what's called a blacklist. And anything that comes from that person will be automatically filtered out. And likewise, if you get things that are being filtered that you want to click keep, you would go into your spam folder and mark it as not junk. And then you build a whitelist, and anything from those people aren't filtered out. For someone like me, it's important because I get a lot of email from companies selling stuff since I have a business. Now, an email filter may grab that automatically, seeing it's mostly advertisements, and filter it out. So you need to train your software to look for it. And for those of you who are a little more advanced, if you have a software package on your computer, you could also do what are called message filters. Because doing a spam filter is okay, but if you get a message from Joe at abc.com and filter him, well, the next one's gonna come from Sam at abc.com, and then you'll have to filter him. So if you notice you're getting a lot of junk that has something in common, you could set up a message filter on that in common. So you're like, you could filter everything that comes from abc.com automatically, and that'll cover all of it. If it is an email list you did not sign up for, do not use the unsubscribe. Number one, it probably won't work. And number two, what you'll be doing is you'll be verifying your email address to the spammer. A lot of spamming, a lot of this stuff on Facebook where they say, well, you send an email here and Microsoft or Dell or whoever is going to send you something. They're not going to do it, believe me. They're not. And all that person is doing is collecting verified email addresses, and verified email addresses are worth money. The cloud. How many of you have no idea really what the cloud is? In its simplicity, the cloud is anything that runs on the internet. And the term the cloud came from this. When people first started doing diagrams with the internet. Since you don't really know and it doesn't really matter what's there, they just drew it as a cloud. That's where the term the cloud came from. The cloud started as what's called software as a service, SaaS or SaaS. And they call it the cloud because that's friendlier terminology to most people. Basically, all it is services running out on someone's server on the internet that you or your company use. Your email is technically a cloud service because it runs on the internet. But a lot of businesses do storage, they do applications, they do all kinds of things out on the internet in the cloud. What are the advantages of the cloud? It costs less. You don't have to have servers and software and licensing and everything on you, at your office. It's on somebody else's property for them to worry about. Ease of access. Anything that's on the cloud can be accessed anywhere that you can get an internet connection. So if you have a fleet of salesmen that go throughout the country doing this and that, you can put all that your sales information on the cloud server somewhere, and they can get it from anywhere around the world. Improved communication. Like I was just saying with the example I gave, your communication with your employees, with your customers, and everything can be improved. And it's a consistency thing. This way, whoever's giving a presentation on something from your company can have the same exact files. So you're getting a consistent message then. And I have found, see, the difference between me and most people that will talk to you, most sales people who try and sell you things on the internet or whatever, they tell you the good parts, but I'm going to tell you the bad parts. The disadvantages of the cloud. Security is number one. Anything and everything can be hacked. And if you're brash enough to say, you can't hack my network, you're just going to cheese off the hackers and they're going to come after you. Anything can be hacked. I mean, big companies have been hacked. The United States government has been hacked. What if your connection goes down? Or even worse, their connection go down. Recently, a couple months ago, Amazon had a catastrophe because a big piece of their cloud went offline. If theirs goes offline or yours goes offline, there's no way you're going to get to it. And you to an extent, you have a loss of control because your information, your applications and everything is sitting out on someone else's server. And I had something like this happen to me personally, and Tim can vouch for this because he was involved with it. The internet service provider we use, I guess they were renting services somewhere, and that company went out of business. So for 2 days, Tim's website was offline because it was on one of those servers that got shut down, and they had to get the backups of, they had to either get the servers or backups of the servers so they could put up new servers and get us back online. And that can happen with anything that's on the internet. My recommendation would be building what they call a local cloud. A local cloud is when you have it within your company. It has a lot of the same advantages. It's not as expensive. It's not as expensive as if you had to put all this on everybody's computer. It is a little more expensive than using the remote cloud because you have to have an IT staff, you need internet connections, and if you're smart, you'll have two internet connections, so you have some redundancy. Two internet connections from two different companies. Or a dial-up or backup of some sort, so you don't ever go completely down. And you need to buy all this hardware and software yourself. But your local cloud, for your people that are remote, works the same as a remote cloud. They can still get into it, get all their information, you have the consistency, you have the everything that the regular cloud has. The local cloud is also safer, since everything is on your premises and in your control. I mean, it still can be hacked, but you don't have to worry about someone from some other company doing something to your data or selling it or giving it away or whatever. Like I said, it's in your control, which to me is important. I don't like letting my data go to anybody. The Internet of Things. The Internet of Things is, or IoT. The Internet of Things is, like I said, all the devices you have. Your phones, your tablets, these days your car, your house, your, who knows, the appliances someday may be controlled on the Internet. We live in a very connected society these days, and everything is getting connected, and to a sense, that scares me too. What are the advantages? They are built to connect. There are, if you enable it, your tablet, your phone, if it's connected, can automatically, through Bluetooth, connect to another phone and pass information. You're connected to the Internet. You're connected wherever. They are built to connect and make communication happen. File sharing is an important part of these devices too. Either downloading files or sharing files or however you might want to do it. And things like, we're getting into where we've all seen the commercials. Oh, the dad turns on the, he's on the East Coast at a job, and he turns on his car in the Midwest. You know, remote control of your house. Oh, my locks unlock as soon as I walk up with my cell phone. I don't even have to take out a key. You can control the cameras, you control the lights, you can control everything in your house remotely. And that scares me even more. Disadvantages of the Internet of Things. The devices are not as secure as your computer is coming out of the box. I've heard there is ways of doing security. I have to look into that myself. Your device can be hacked. If you can do it with your device, someone else can do it for you. All they would have to do is hack your codes. It can be done, and I heard a few months ago that they found a flaw. I don't know. I don't remember if it was in the iOS from Apple or Android from Google, where it could be exploited to do just that. And also, from the point of view of businesses, transactions, file transfers, etc., on a device, don't leave any kind of trail. When you have communications, emails, letters, whatever, you have a paper trail. Companies that are traded on the stock market, according to Sarbanes-Oxley, have to keep emails for 10 years. That's why for these people, spam is a bad thing, because even all those spam messages need to be stored away on a server somewhere for 10 years as a paper trail, because it's all legal evidence in court. But when you're doing it on a device or even through instant messaging on a computer, there is no tracing it. There's no record. And a lot of companies don't allow these things because of that. And also, if you use your phone, your personal phone at your business, you probably signed an agreement that says that your business can wipe your phone completely clean at any time. Because if you quit, you lose your phone, they fire you, they have their data on your phone and they don't want it going anywhere else. We have an election coming up, and electronic voting is becoming more and more popular. Again, I wouldn't do it myself for all the reasons I've just given. It can be hacked, it can be cheated, how secure is it? Once you do a paper ballot, it's done. It can't really, it couldn't as easily be changed. And security is a huge issue. Barring the hanging and pregnant chance that we learned about in the Bush-Gore election. I've said this before, what are the three most important things in computer security? Be careful, be careful, be careful. Common sense is your best weapon. If it seems too good to be true, it probably is. And a lot of the earlier scams, a lot of the scams that have gone through, if you think about it, you wouldn't fall for it. I'll give you two examples. One of the first scams that came out was, oh, my long-lost uncle died and is leaving me $30 million, but I need $5,000 in fees to collect it. Now, if you would think about it, a will is a legal document. It is a hard and fast legal document that is very difficult to challenge or change. If you go into a bank, I don't think any bank in the world would deny this. If you went into a bank with a will that says you're going to inherit $20 million, I think they would loan you $5,000 to collect it. Another popular one is, I'm here stuck in Europe. I need to get money to my friend in the United States. I'm going to send you a check for $100. You send him $90, and you can keep the $10. If it wasn't a scam, it would be illegal because it's money laundering. So if you use a little common sense, you can usually see through these things. That concludes my half of the presentation. So we bring up Tim.
Stole my logo.
No, that was Tim. Talk to Tim.
Yeah. It's like not stealing your logo, Charlie. It's called fair use.
With the haircut.
It's called fair use, Charlie. Well, now we're going to get into some good stuff now. We all know Google's watching you, and you're watching back. As you can see, you know, you got the spy versus spy stuff. Google's watching you. But anything you do online is going to be brought in. It's going to be hacked, and you're going to be watched. I'm going to share with you a little bit of a story not too long ago that happened to me on how some of this stuff actually happened. You know, when our data works, and you have, you know, the clouds and the cookies in your browser and everything else working well, it can be a very pleasurable experience because the ads you get reflect your interests. The things that happen work, and it's also a marketer's dream when this stuff actually happens because you can really learn quite a bit from it. But as you can see with this next story, if you look at something a little bit out of the norm, or perhaps maybe do something else, some strange things can actually happen to you. For example, I do a little bit of videography. I wanted to do my brother's wedding and film a couple of others. I don't know the first thing about bridal gowns. I don't know the first thing about fashion trends. So what did I do? I watched some videos for about 20 hours, unencrypted on my browser, of the program called Say Yes to the Dress. Yeah, I learned a lot. But what I didn't do was there was some rather unanticipated consequences from that thing. I think the next slide's exactly what I'm going to show you. Here's what happened. You're sitting here watching Mind and Marvels on YouTube and watch.
I'm just not crazy about it.
Yeah.
This is it. I found my dress. I love it. What do you think?
You won't have to resort to drastic measures when shopping at the perfect dress. We have gowns to please the most discriminating tastes. Service is our promise and our pleasure. No duct tape necessary.
No duct tape necessary. I'm watching some online programs, and I keep getting these banner ads in. Bridal Stone Gown Store. You just saw a little bit of a perfect example that I kind of did myself. The problem is that this stuff just kept a coming and a coming.
Right.
You're learning to film a wedding, and now you're having one. The banner ads, they just kept a coming. I mean, you know, say yes to the dress. I only watched 20 hours of it. But for some reason, that got into my cookie so bad that what you saw last time was a fairly common occurrence until I actually went in and changed my web preferences at, Andy, can you, when I actually changed my web preferences.
It's too loud for over there.
Oh, okay, just, all right.
You said something, we gotta watch it.
Oh, sure, maybe we can, all right, thanks. But anyway, as we were saying, the banner ads, they just kept a-coming and a-coming. And to be honest with you, this is what actually happened after I filmed my brother. That's Chris's bride, Chris, on a beach at the Virgin Islands. So it obviously, the work I did do a little something. That's her. That's my brother's wife. So you can see it does do a little bit of something. But at what cost? I did learn to film, but at what cost? More, that's kind of a diagram of what many of you girls want your husbands to do after a while. Never mind that. The thing is, though, what I found later on was a little something called the, you know, my data was there for a long time. We'll go back one here. We'll better go back to this one. Because what happened was after a while, it seemed like the data was keeping me under hostage or siege for a while. And I was, in a sense, married to it. But, as I said, there are ways out of here. There's a little device on the internet called Tor. It's the Onion browser with the Onion router, and I'll give a brief presentation of that after we go through the main thing here. But basically what it does is it allows you to have real explicit an affair with your data, I will allow no one to find out. And I'll give you a quick demonstration a little later on. As Paul said, there is something that's even worse for these marketers that's coming out that will be worse for you. It's called the Internet of Things. It started out basically, it's basically a connected community, 16 billion wireless devices, thousands of devices, thousands of things, and in a lot of cases, you can see that you get your smartphone connected. You know, it all started a long time ago in 1998 when a college in a computer laboratory at the University of Cambridge was connected to the internet with the internet to monitor its coffee pot. And this was in 1994 before things started in 1995. You know, after a while, it could even be said that Google, current technology will allow you from a router to go from 250 to 300 connected devices within each home. Many manufacturers employ a single kind of microcontroller across a large range of appliances. A microcontroller being a toaster, a little bit of computer in the toaster, the microwave, for example. And it's only a matter of time before they can all, you know, get a little extra software, get some Wi-Fi capability, and get connected. And, you know, why would somebody want to connect their appliances, though, in the first place? You know, really, why would somebody do that? Well, you guys have heard of the thing called a smart grid, right? And Google actually purchased a company for about $40 billion in 2014 that actually was a monitoring service for these for the thermostats. This next clip will explain a little bit more about the connected thermostat.
Walking back and forth with the thermostat builds leg muscles. When the internet's come to life and all these gizmos turn on us, these kids won't be able to run away on those shriveled little calves. Will they love the internet's thermostat then? I don't think so.
The Nest Learning Thermostat. Welcome to a more thoughtful home.
Yes, the Nest Thermostat. And the thing is, what happens when it gets to your refrigerator?
Spell check.
Automated reordering of milk, cheese, and other essentials delivered by drone, and of course, to your home. It already exists. Amazon.com has a little something that they call the reorder button that you can put anywhere. It's got a little microprocessor in it. You press it, and you get your item automatically ordered. That means you can take a bottle of detergent with this button on it, press it, and automatically have it delivered to your home next day through Amazon. Of course, they have your credit card information. And of course, they do have within a 30-minute period of cancellation in case your five-year-old decides to hit that button a number of times, and all of a sudden you get a whole bunch of ordering. The problem is, this is more scams and more data that's now available for your marketers. For example, I can get this, nuts. No, I just forgot to, well, that's the wrong one, sorry.
Processors that will instantly compute the intelligence and, in a continuous feedback loop, engage connected devices and communicate actions, offers, insights, and alerts. Cisco estimates that the Internet of Things will bloom to involve 50 billion connected things in the world, with trillions of connections among them. The Internet of Things is currently generating more than $1 trillion in revenues, and this hyper-connected future could represent a $14 trillion annual business within 10 years. Location-sensitive transmitters, called beacons, are already sending targeted advertising messages to smartphones and mobile devices based on their precise indoor location. For example, in the cereal aisle of a supermarket or the jeans department of a clothing store. Beacons are a reality and represent the future of shopper marketing. They're just one more technological advance in mobile and out-of-home communications that marketers, retailers, agencies, and need to understand and build into their business model. The waking giant in the Internet of Things business is Google, which wants to be computing literally everywhere, from your kitchen sink to your tool shed, and there's no other company today with the resources, skill set, and consumer connections that's also willing to risk assets and create long-term plans for building such a massive infrastructure. Google's recent acquisition of Nest represents both a strategic asset as well as a marketing plan. Purchase a Nest dishwasher and send a command via your Android device. Log in to Google Plus and turn the lights on in your garage. Activate the security system. View different rooms in your home. Check whether you're out of milk and leave a message on the fridge. From Cisco to GE to Google, the Internet of Things is at the forefront of companies' future planning, and you're missing the next wave of technology if you're not paying attention. MyersBizNet members can read more about major technology advances at MyersBizNet.com or contact me, Jack Myers, at jm@jackmyers.com.
As you can see, a classic marketing message for what? More spam. Just think, every time you open your garage door, the business knows what time you're coming home. Just think, the business will know what time you're gone, when you turn down your heat, what time you go to bed, huh? Charlie, what'd you do?
You're on.
I'm on?
The mic's not on, though.
You're on.
Mic on?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, I got a couple more clips, and then I'm going to show you a little bit about the Tor browser, and then we'll wrap it up. But it's, as we see with more of our privacy invasions, things are going to go on. Here's a good warning by Steve Wozniak. Hang on a second, we're going to just...
Charlie's got it.
That other guy was spooky.
Yeah.
Okay.
Charlie's got the volume.
Oh, he does?
Yeah.
There's nothing on.
Okay, hang on here.
Start over.
Yeah. All right.
There we go. Stir her up.
Does the Internet of Things mean that everything you use in your life, I guess...
Can you hear that, Charlie?
...fountain pens and everything on your wall and your lights and your home, they'll all get smarter and smarter. And on the Internet, tons of companies starting up because these products are generally small today and don't need a huge amount of development capital and all that. And there being so many investments, and I'm sort of feeling it's like a bubble. Eventually, we're going to get to where almost everything is on the Internet working for us in our lives. But I mean, sometimes there's a pace at which human beings can change the way they do things. That's why all the investment into the Internet in like around the late 1990s and 2000, all that investment went in saying the Internet's going to be everything in life. And the investors were correct. The trouble is it couldn't happen so fast, so the bubble burst. There were huge economic downfalls and all that. This is what Steve Jobs brought us in our lives. When he came back to Apple, he was really good at making sure it had to be good in his mind for him. So I think management is basically more important. Look at a school. What's more important? The students, the books, or the teachers? And generally, it boils down to the teachers. Students will never kind of achieve beyond the expectations of the teachers and the abilities of the teachers.
Yeah, that's true. They're idiots.
Yeah. As you can see, we have a slight warning with Mr. Wozniak and his Internet of Things. Finally, that's the end. What I'm going to do now is go online itself and show you a little bit about how you can browse the web anonymously. And it's a fairly simple thing. As you can see right now, I have a simple Chrome browser up. But if you go to something called Tor Network, what you'll find out is that the Tor project is what they call anonymity online. You can download the browser for free. You can get on it. And if you want to go to those dark websites, which are otherwise known as .onion, we can show you. This is Chrome, but I'm going to show you now how Tor works. I've downloaded a copy to my computer here, and it comes up as it says, like, start Tor browser. If you know how to, download Chrome or another one that I like called Torch, which is basically another one that allows me to download videos, it goes. But the Start Tor, what it simply does is it finds other systems that are running Tor, and it kind of descrambles where you're coming from so that they can't trace you right away. It opens up, and then the default page is a search engine called Disconnect Me. So let's just say I wanted to find something like pot. You know, we can go pot.
Really, Tim.
And we could probably find something online right away and buy it through Bitcoin if we wanted to. But I don't know if this will work here or not because it is a network. But it says Pot Summary or Potash Corporation, pot.com, all kinds of different things in here on it. This web strikes attracting, as you can see, but there are things. If you go to a normal Google site, for example, and type in pot and then dot onion, the dot onion is not read by Google, but it's read by a lot of other stuff on it. You could probably find out more about it. But in Tor itself, you can probably find out more about it as you go on. And if you dig a little bit, this is sort of the gateway to a lot of the illicit activities on the web. But it also will allow you to research a topic, like, for example, a friend of yours is having a health problem, and yet you don't want it in your browser history or let your employer know that you're looking at it. So you just go ahead and go into a Tor browser and use it. It'll connect to all the major search engines. It'll connect to everything else. But it is a good way of doing things. And if you just do a little bit of online research, you know, Tor was something that I use fairly common now when I have to do some off-the-wall topic or I'm involved in something that I don't really want the powers that be to look at. And if you must stay online and you're a little bit ever, most of you probably know that Chrome has what they call a incognito mode, which basically doesn't record it to your history, but the web servers and all the marketing companies will still do it for you. With that, I would like to end this presentation now and take your questions if you have them.
All right.
Now let's get the first questioner in. Okay, we'll start. Go right here. Caitlin.
I'm getting there.
In a lot of ways, what he did was he mentioned the movie Colossus, the Corbin Project. That's exactly what we're coming to, in a lot of ways. You guys remember the movie 1984? That's what we're coming to with the amount of data they got on you. The amount of stuff they got on you, and a lot of other things. It's scary. I mean, you know, it's amazing how many people will give up a little bit of convenience. I mean, a lot of privacy for a little more convenience. And I know you had one in the back, so Rom's coming up to help moderate in a minute, but go ahead. Yes.
Okay, first, two-part question.
Loud, please.
Two-part question. First, what's Chrome? One.
Google.
Two,
I'm gonna get a,
what
I'm
would
get
one a, be, want to be anonymous for on the internet?
Well, how about this? Chrome is another type of web browser. Much like Internet Explorer is, Chrome is made by Google. Firefox is made by the Mozilla and the Mozilla Foundation. There's also another one that I like called Torch, which is got some built-in downloadable video capabilities where I can download stuff from YouTube and things. There's also a ton of others. There's Apple, it's got Safari. It's all about the same stuff. What Tor is a browser that runs off a Firefox platform that basically masks your IP address so that you can browse anonymously and people don't know where you're coming from.
What are some things they can want to be browsing anonymously?
Well, take for example, if I have a friend of mine who has mesothelioma. Yeah. Mesothelioma is the $30 word when you click on it on Google, and if you do that, you're going to get a lot of banner ads for mesothelioma and other medical conditions.
Would terrorists be using it?
I'm sure they are.
Okay. What if you live in Iran or China?
Actually, if you live in Iran and China, the Tor browser was actually configured by the U.S. Department of Defense for the explicit reason that underground movements could exist without government intrusion. So that whole Tor browser was an invention of the United States government for usage for underground movements in Iran so that they could not be traced. Likewise, though, what you have is the same tools can be used for good or ill. But, you know, we've always had organized crime. We've always had stuff. Go ahead, Paul.
Another thing on that is anyone who might want to cover their trail would like something like that. If you're doing illegal activities, say you're married and you can't kick that porn habit, you know, anything like that. Anyone who might want to cover their trail would be interested in something like that. Or a person who just doesn't want to be bothered with it. Like I had to get a tablet that's connected because of my work, but I turn off the location feature. I don't want people knowing where I am. I only use what I have to on it.
Okay. Yes.
Kind of a related thing, let's say. You know, if I wanted to watch, I don't know how to give you an example of this. After the terrorist attack thing, they had a site that you were supposedly go to learn how to donate blood, you know, for the that. And then when I went to that, it has to show me a fucking ad before it'll get to that thing. Is there a way to bypass ads?
Right now, there's not a real good way to bypass ads, but that's what I'm talking about, the annoyance of marketers. You know, you want to get blood in a site that says go here, and then you got to watch a commercial. That,
I know, it's so annoying.
It just gets annoying. You know, and many of the YouTube videos that you have now with the ads, you as a subscriber to YouTube can turn those on or off. With my own YouTube account, I have not what I call monetized it, so you won't see those ads in my Toastmaster stuff or any of the other things that you see. Paul, you want to comment?
Sure. One of the reasons you have ads, and I know some places it's ridiculous, is no website is free. You have to pay for hosting. You have to pay for development. You have to pay for security. It all costs money. There are some sites that try and take donations, but they usually don't last very long. The ads are there so that they don't have to charge you for using the site. If they didn't have the ad there, they'd probably charge you $5 to get the information.
I'll give you a good example. Today on the MSN homepage, there was a sponsored link, it said, you know, in the news thing about a wonderful new way of energy, you know, that's going to be cheap and free and whatever. And I click on that, and you're like waiting and waiting. It's got to just run through all the stuff. And like at some point, I just give up.
And everyone really got to what I'm supposed to see. Now for a word from our sponsor.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous at some
point. Well, the thing is, a lot of times what you can find is if you know enough about it, you're going to find the content's usually available out on YouTube or some other place anyway. I noticed one guy, for example, not too long ago who took the videos of Gordon McDowell from the Thorium Energy Alliance, which are available for free as a user. He's now running banner ads off of YouTube, and he's got so dang many commercials in there that, you know, you get sick of it after a while. In other words, what that's called is piracy hacking and redistribution, not under fair use, but under trying to make money. And in some cases, you know, you get some people in here who just basically abuse the privilege. Now, I know with a lot of the internet marketers I do, I don't mind watching an ad now and then. I don't mind, you know, doing something. But one time I was watching a YouTube video and it went to a Volvo ad, and it was a half an hour long. I couldn't get out of it and find out to the next part of the show. I said, the heck with it. I just closed my browser and went on my way. And even now, you know, too, Google did one thing right. They had the sponsored links on the one part and the, you know, unsubstantiated content or searchable content on the other. What brought down many of the search engines in the 90s, like Alta Vista and Dogpile and a few of the others, was because they were a lot of the advertisers were paying to be held at the top of the search engine. Okay. Any other?
Bill West.
Okay, Bill?
Yeah, you guys understood anything about the National Security Agency?
Yes, we have seen stuff about the National
Security Agency. Well, you haven't seen anything.
Well, we didn't say anything about it because what this basically more was about was not, you know, we were talking about some of the ways of doing it over, and I was also telling you a little bit about my own personal history. You know, even though the bride and the banner ad, I call it, might be a little bit of a cynical way of looking at the commercials, it actually happened to me. I've also been hacked twice to my own personal debit card, And I've also been a victim of a very minor thing of identity fraud about 10 years ago when somebody actually got into another, stole a credit card from me. And with this bank account I have now, I've been hacked at least twice where I've had to get new cards issued. Now, as far as the National Security Agency is concerned, there is a lot of information about them. They are the spy agency that is the spy agency. And what they do is they record almost everything on the internet. There has been recently a new location out in Utah that is a server farm that you can go to Wired Magazine and look at, and it's basically going to record an entire year's worth of internet, every website, everything about. If you take a look, it's in Wired Magazine. Just look at the, Google in the NSA and Utah, and why you'll find the article, Paul.
Larry?
Hang on.
No.
All right. Next.
Larry? Now, with the answer you speak of, when it comes to YouTube, I think they give you the option where it's just the first 5 seconds of a commercial. You can click on that one click and then not see the commercial.
It depends on the type of ad. There are some that are so annoying, they won't let you click off. But they have to pay a premium for that. There are some out there that pull up in the middle of a YouTube thing that are three times as loud as what you're listening to. So, for example, if I'm watching television at night and I got my computer hooked up to it, so I'm watching a program, all of a sudden, three times loud, that's a little crazy. In other words, a lot of times we don't mind banner advertising, we don't mind getting marketed to, but there's a time and a place for everything. You don't want your toothbrush ordering your toothpaste. You don't want your five-year-old pressing a button and ordering 10 boxes of cereal. You don't want your kids getting on your computer and ordering stuff on eBay because you've chosen to keep your PayPal account open, which is, believe it or not, has happened to me. Since I sell goods online through eBay, there's been a number of cases where order cancellations come through because they say, my kid ordered this by mistake. No, more than likely you didn't. You kept your PayPal browser open and your kid was able to figure out how to order a TV without you being around.
Oh, right.
Okay.
Well, also, with all this, as I pointed on my part of the speech, you don't want someone coming back in at you either. That I feel is the biggest threat. My biggest problem with the ads on like YouTube and such, you have a TV show which has ad breaks built into it, but then they don't use, why can't they put the commercials they're putting in where the breaks are? They stick it in just wherever, and that's my only big complaint about the ads.
Caitlin?
Okay, this one is for my dad. There is a way to get security on a tablet and cell phone.
Go ahead.
I think if you have an Android phone for Google Play users, you can go on Google Play and search security software. And
you
it'll
have a question?
I'm just letting you know that there's
That's
a way.
That's a rebuttal. I did mention that there is a way of doing security, and I would have to research it. I'm new to devices, and I haven't had a chance to look into that yet. But thank you for your information, Caitlin.
You're welcome.
You get rebuttal time.
Okay.
Everybody gets a...
All right. Same question. Dan, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, you said something about an incognito for Firefox or
yes,
Google?
When you look at most browsers are going to have some kind of incognito.
Where is that?
I'll show you after the words, but if you look... Okay. At Google, for example, or the Chrome browser, mm-hmm. you're going to find something that says incognito mode on it. It lets you browse the web. Maybe when you right-click on
private. Is it called private?
Private.
Probably in the settings under security.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, for their private mode or incognito mode, it's going to be in there somewhere.
Okay.
Now, go ahead, Brahman, let us know our next one.
Let's see. Charlie,
Charlie?
Isn't all of this perfectly allowable under the law
under free market capitalism.
Oh my God.
And there's no, is there, well, let me finish, Neil. He's the moderator. See that guy over there? And is it true there's no guaranteed expectation of privacy in the Constitution as a right?
Which amendment?
From what my understanding of the Constitution is, there is a right to privacy that's been defined by the Supreme Court and by the 14th Amendment for unreasonable search and seizure. Or the 4th, I'm sorry.
Or, it's an expression only.
Yeah, it's not explicitly put in, but, you know, during the times of the colonists, there were papers you wanted to have and you didn't want to get yourself searched. With the internet itself, you know, it's a right now a wild, wide open west, so to speak. It hasn't barely been regulated too much. And about the only real form of web self-regulation has been what they call the
RFCs.
Go ahead and explain what an RFC is.
Okay, in the way the internet was put together, there is no governing body of the internet. The RFCs are requests for comments, are the basic rules of the internet as we use it. They're suggestions. You can do whatever you want. But if you want somebody to find you, it's best that you follow the suggestions they put forth. There is no really regulating body of the internet. The United States government would love to own it and take care of it, but it's not. I don't think it's going to happen. And that's the way it was set up from the beginning. And as far as privacy, what I do is I assume everything I find on the internet is a lie. I mean, I meet people in chat and they get upset because I don't trust them. And I'm like, well, you got to do something to prove yourself to me. Trust is earned, not given. But I know you. And I know the group.
How difficult would it be for the United States government, if they were so inclined, to completely take over and or shut down the internet? And how difficult would it be for some other nefarious group? Well, there's only 12 centers or something. Anyway, he'll answer the question. Okay, some other nefarious person or group to take over or shut down the internet, at least in one country.
In a sense, that happens today because in countries like Pakistan and China, they control what goes in and out of their own country.
Okay.
The United States government couldn't take over the whole internet because it is international.
Okay.
It would be difficult. It would be difficult for them to take it over in this country because all of the hardware is privately held, and a lot of it. Who knows where Google has servers? Who knows where Microsoft has servers? All these cloud companies—they have servers everywhere and anywhere. So even if they shut down all the servers in the United States, you would still have servers from elsewhere that people can get to.
And I'll comment a little further on. You see, the one thing that you got to realize, too, is it's not just the cloud, but a lot of times the hardware of the internet, too, is rather extensive. A lot of damage could be done, for example, if you went right and cut one of those transatlantic cables or fiber optic lines that go through the ocean. They're no more than the thickness of a hose, but yet the amount of data they transmit is quite substantial. Though today, what would happen if you cut a cable across the Atlantic? It would go across the Pacific. You would see a noticeable decline in speed on the web traffic. But remember, the World Wide Web and the internet were designed by the U.S. government. And the reason they were designed by the U.S. government was they wanted to maintain communications through a connected network in case of atomic attack. Go ahead, Paul.
Just one more comment. The World Wide Web and the Internet, a web network or a mesh network, is literally where every point is connected to every other point directly. It's not that way, but it comes a very good approximation. Like Tim said, if a path from one point to the other is cut, you just go around a different way. It may take a little longer, but the communications would still be good.
Okay. I have a question. Paul, excuse me. Any blockage from this spam at least 50%? Maybe how to block? Because sometimes, like, I have sometimes more than 200 spams, and I sit and click, like, it takes like 20 minutes to just erase. Where is it coming from? I'm very careful.
You're not going to get rid of spam.
It's possible.
It's always
going to
come. But instead of deleting it on the program you're reading it from, there should be a button or something to mark it as spam or junk or whatever. If you do that, it will set up a filter, and messages from that sender will automatically be filtered out.
But it's in the future, perhaps, when I check my email, it's going to be from different sources in spam?
Well, yeah, that's true, but there's nothing you can do about it.
So it's impossible to block even 50% blockage?
If you get too much, the best advice I can give you is to get a different email address. And if you one more thing real quick, since we're talking on spam. If you get a strange email from a friend, say one that says, your friend Joe is in Europe and he's lost his money, call your friend Joe on the phone, tell him his email account has been hacked, and tell him to change his password and contact his provider.
No, it's scam, of course.
I got a question.
A lot of people follow.
Okay.
I got a question for both you guys. It's a two-part question.
Well, let's get a little louder so we can hear you.
I have a two-part question. One, what does it mean if something goes viral, and how do you become viral on the internet? My second part is Twitter just a communication source, and it's virtually useless except for celebrity and media? And then three parts. Are they collecting, if you email or look at a website, can they tap into you and like find all your contacts and steal them?
Okay.
So that's the third part. Can they steal all your contacts?
For something going viral,
yeah,
is when you post something online, say to Facebook or one of the other social media accounts, and you get, I don't know the number, but like millions of clicks, millions of likes or views or whatever, that's going viral. Or am I wrong?
You are wrong.
I think
it's hundreds. No, it's basically going viral means if you post a picture or a status or something like on Facebook or any other social media site, and you get over a few hundred, then you went viral.
Okay. Yeah, but don't you nothing, share it?
Nothing
with other people.
They share it.
Okay. What you do is you post something online, it goes to your friends, and then it goes to their, you know the old story? You tell two people, and they tell two people, and they tell two people, and so on and so on. It works very fast on the internet.
So it's sharing.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Nothing on the internet is truly one way.
Well, Twitter is, right?
No.
Twitter is except if you're a celebrity or a...
When you send a message to a server, a request to a server, or a packet to a message to a server, there is information in that server that it'll have your IP address, it'll have what browser you're using, some information like that. So nothing is completely private either.
And that's part three of my question, right? Can people tap into your email and like steal your personal information and your contact?
It can be done, but you can be, if you're careful about it, it won't happen.
If you're a computer.
It won't happen by you. If you're on the internet, browsing the internet, someone's not going to come back in at your computer and steal everything off you. They may come in and plant a zombie, which is a program that sits there until it's activated. Then they activate the zombie into what's called a botnet. All these zombies on hundreds and thousands of computers start working together, And that may start sending things out on your email or whatever.
Taking my personal information and my contacts.
Right.
Okay. I've been asked by websites to say, and they would say, can we take all your personal information? Can we take all your contacts? And I'm like, no.
That,
why would you even
have yes, yeah, Facebook right would do
that's
that.
On, that's on Facebook.
Facebook.
The when nerve.
Yeah, when you sign up for an app on Facebook, a lot of times they'll ask
yeah,
that.
Facebook.
Because they want to tell all your friends that you're playing their game.
It's on Facebook.
Mike, the app is strictly the 1.5 questions.
Okay.
At a time.
All right. Doc.
Speaking of the Internet of Things, you guys know about the Michael Hastings incident where he died in a car crash, and it's speculated that someone hacked the car, his new car, it was connected to the internet, and someone
you know, that's
the car.
What really scares me about a lot of these internet connecting of things, especially like with the driving, you know, like you said with the Michael Hastings incident. Yeah. If it can be connected, even like with your remote door locks, and you forget your key and you call up a place, and then they say, oh, we'll do it for you, and unlock your car, it's a great matter of convenience, but if they can do it, somebody else can. And if you're hacked, imagine what it would be like for law enforcement just to send a signal to your car, slow you down, and you're taken care of. Or they have some of that too already, but you got to remember that the more we're connected with the world, the more convenience we have through data connections and things like this, the more marketers are going to be able to quote-unquote, use the opportunity to make money. Now, if you remember back in the 30s, they had thought at one point, well, what I mean is if you go back that far, there was a point that was, that they had said people would need and had everything that they needed or wanted. And one of the ways that they first started selling cosmetics was to make women feel insecure about their appearance, like when they were 14, and start selling them cosmetics.
Uh-oh.
And like even now today with Instagram and all the Facebook stuff that goes on, a lot of teenage girls are trying to get their social status updated by what people look like and what they don't and everything else. You can find out a lot more about this if you go to This American Life. There was a brief story on status. It's very interesting. Most of you who have teenage girls probably know this already. Some of us guys who don't have it, been around this stuff for a few years, don't know about it. But I'm saying, what are we coming to? We got all these smartphones, we got all this new data connection technology, and what's it being used for? Status updates on the local high school social network web. To me, I don't give a hoot. I'm glad I can go to the Library of Congress, access my TV programs like Modern Marvels and Top Gear, but the other stuff I can live without, but for some of the women, they think that's the most important thing in the world. The bottom line is data can be used for good or for ill. It's a tool, Paul. All right.
Okay, George, did you have a question? George, Vanessa's?
Yeah.
Okay.
Andy, you got anything?
Let's see. Larry has another question.
Okay, go ahead.
Here's an accidental way of how to get less spam in your email account. This is something that I found out a few years ago where I had my email account tied to not a credit card or a bank account. I was just paying my phone bill on a monthly basis. So I stopped paying the phone bill like 2 months in a row, and eventually AT&T closed the account, and I had to pay for it at a currency exchange. So I didn't have a phone or the internet for maybe about a day or two.
Right.
And when it got reconnected, a lot of that spam was just gone. It never came back because they saw, you know, they keep testing the computer. If it's not getting a hit, they just don't hit it anymore.
I've done that with my CoreCom account. I did it about 10 years ago.
Did everybody get that question?
Yeah, what he's asking is one of the best ways he got rid of a lot of spam in his email account was he went through a process of voluntary disconnection with AT&T, for a day or so, paid the bill at the currency exchange, then reactivated the same email address. It worked for me about maybe 10 years ago when I went through a voluntary disconnection with a company that I maintain a personal email account with CoreCom, and it did work at that time. Paul, any other suggestions?
At this point, I just had a thought. I want to say something on passwords, since we're talking about accounts being hacked. What makes us good secure? You must have a password in some places. If you use password as your password, don't complain when you get hacked. If you use your name as your password, I'm not a good person. I use my daughter's name as my password.
Good idea. Telling the
what's your daughter's name?
Good idea.
But I use letters and numbers with it. So
it's not just breaking into your account right now.
A good password, the usual rules they say, 8 to 32 characters, the more the merrier. Use uppercase and lowercase numbers and symbols as much as they will allow you. I've seen places their password rules won't allow you to use special characters. And that's one of the things I've always been told. And the special characters, if you shift the numbers, those are the special characters. The pound sign, the at sign, the exclamation point, all of those things. And you don't want to spell out actual words.
What about using the same password for many things?
Yeah, that's not a good idea either, because if he gets one, then he gets them all. Yeah. And I'm guilty as charged on that one, too. So. Mm-hmm. I'm not the best, but I'm careful so I don't get hacked. And also, what I've seen, and it can work, depending on the situation, like spelling out password, P, at sign, 55W0RD. Yeah. Replacing numbers for letters, symbols for letters. You can remember it better, and it's more secure because you're not just spelling out the word.
Go ahead, Charlie.
All right, Charlie, you're in. You're ready.
What's your question, Charlie?
Not that important. I'm somewhat amazed that my email service can identify all this spam when I look at it, and I don't believe it's on sheer volume. How is that? I mean, these guys are darn good at that. And they're very accurate, for the most part, virtually.
The companies that make security software, Symantec, Trend Micro, McAfee, et cetera, they work together watching for spammers. That they'll see 500 emails coming off this one server or something, and they'll investigate it, and they have lists of domain names and such that are known spammers. And when you get and that can be programmed into your ISP's firewall, your firewall, your computer, and that's how they can block spam and garbage websites and such before they even get to your network.
You're really good at it.
Okay. Hi, Andy.
Is anybody expressing any concern about, you said 250 or 300 possible devices in a home could be, Wi-Fi enabled and everything else? Is anybody thinking about what happens when one of those things is damaged by a ComEd power surge? They're all microprocessors now. What's the downside? Now, I noticed you didn't talk about that tonight. What can happen when one of these devices fails, much less anybody maliciously hacking it?
That's what I think. What I know I didn't mention a lot about the downside of the Internet of Things. My speech was geared to say, watch out. The Internet of Things is coming, and the marketers are there awaiting you. Now, not just marketing, but Andy is right. If a lot of our appliances already have a microprocessor built in, like a microwave and a refrigerator, and most of the stuff now is a very common use. And you're right, a power surge can knock a lot of that out right away. And with the way some of the modern appliances are made, you're going to have to get a $200 or $300 main board to get them replaced or fixed. You just can't do it yourself. There is something to be said about, you know, older fashioned redundant systems that come in. You know, it is recommended that you have a power strip that will protect against a power surge when you have computers. It is recommended you have a power strip or a power surge against the new television sets. Now, electronics are great, but like anything else, when they go wrong, you might as well just throw out the device and get a new one. The thing that worries me about these new connected cars, you know, say something goes wrong, it's going to be $500, $700 to get a new piece of equipment or a new main board for your car. You just can't go in and maybe fix something like you could with a mechanical connection. The thing that really worries me, though, about interconnected devices is the amount of what will happen. Say, you know, you get that interconnected thermostat. You get that smart grid that goes down. They know what time you're leaving. They know what time you come back. They know your preferences about your programming history. They know this. And as that data becomes more available in a database and gets hacked, imagine how easy it would be for a burglar to find out, oh, he's not home, he's on vacation. His paper got stopped, is this not taken care of? We'll just go and be a moving company because nobody really knows him out here. And that's what really scares me about all this data that's coming through. You know, the government knows everything there is about you, and private industry knows even more. There is a company out there called AXICOM, Axicom or Axiom. They probably know more about you than the government does, and the government actually buys a lot of their data about you from them. Go ahead, Paul.
One comment on what Tim just said, and they sell it to whoever comes along with dollars to buy it. In answer to Andy's question, power surges aren't as big a threat as they used to be in earlier computers. The chips, the boards, the devices have surge suppression built into them quite often. And if something would blow out, it would depend, in my estimation, it would depend on how it's interconnected with the machine. Does this interface for your device, if that breaks, does the whole machine go down? Say it's on your refrigerator, you want to adjust the temperature in your refrigerator, or make purchases or whatever. Is that controlling overall your refrigerator, or is it just an add-on, something else that's there?
Virtually every appliance I've seen does not have manual overrides when they're electronic board, like on a washer or dryer. Your electronic board goes
right
on top, you gotta buy a new washer.
Right.
Forget about repairing that thing.
And if you want, speaking of safety from those, you can get a device that you put right on where the power comes into your house as a whole house surge suppressor. You can also buy a whole house battery backup that will give you battery power for, I don't know, maybe half an hour or so if the power should go out. And a lot of the uninterruptible power supplies or battery backups have a lot of filtering and isolation circuitry. The UPS you may have under your desk with your computer, what it does is it takes the AC, converts it to DC. The DC does two things. It'll charge your battery, and then they take the DC and convert it back to AC to use for your equipment. So you are completely isolated. Your equipment is completely isolated from what's coming in from ComEd. And that provides even better protection than a surge. And that's one of the reasons they tell you don't plug a surge suppressor into your UPS. You don't need it, and it may affect the circuitry.
Other questions?
Any other? Go ahead.
I understand that with our computers and televisions, they're always on. Even when you shut off and you go to bed at night, you know, because it's plugged into the wall, they're always on. So I understand that not only is the television, with the computer, most of these laptop computers have cameras, and, you know, a little tiny camera, that camera is on all the time.
Yeah.
You know, if you have your laptop open, that camera is on, and as well as the microphone with that computer. So the televisions also have this. The television has microphones. I'm not sure about the camera part, but you're watching TV and it's watching you.
Really?
A lot of times, too, with these new voice activated TVs and voice activated home entertainment systems, there's actually some explicit in the user agreement, if you dig deep. They say we record all your conversations so that we can find out when the TV goes on, when the TV goes off. As a matter of fact, how many of you are familiar with Circe? It's a application for smartphones that allows you to voice browse.
Oh, are you talking about Siri?
Siri. Siri. It tells you how much I know. New stuff to me.
I have a Siri.
Okay. Why don't you
Google has one now too?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, well, it's so cool.
Yeah, go ahead and Caitlin, get in on him and Lee ask Siri a question. Come on up. Yeah. This is what we're talking about. Okay, go ahead. All right.
Hey, Siri.
I changed your accent.
Yes, where am I?
Okay. Where am I? And what is the College of Complexes?
Oh, that Laurel.
And what it did was it gave me a bunch of information. Chamberlain College, John Keller Graduate School of the University. And it tried to answer my question, but I College of Complexes.
You have to speak it like real clear.
Okay.
Yeah.
You want to?
What's the fun things I've had to do with this? One of the fun things I've done with this is, like, if you're someplace and you hear a song playing, you can ask Siri, what's the name of the song it's playing? And it'll listen and it'll tell you the name of the song.
Yeah, ask her if she's married.
I don't know what else said, but there's a lot that can be done with this stuff, and it's pretty cool when the technology comes in. But remember, I guess the bottom line is, be smart. Just know that when you're online, you're being watched, and that most anything you say in a chat room or online or an email is just basically going to be in public. I run a website and a YouTube account that's got about 300 plus subscribers on it. And I do a lot of work on video for Toastmasters. And I also do a lot of, recording of speeches for contests and things online. And I too have to watch my content. There was one time I told a story at a speech contest about my dealings with a certain municipal police department, a little bit of petty corruption that they had. And I went into some detail on it. Well, what I did was I inadvertently just posted it, not thinking nothing of it. Next time I went to another place, a couple of people asked me, hey, Tim, I heard about this thing. What's going on? And sure enough, I kept it up for a while. So what? And it made the rounds, and it got over about 400 or 500 hits before I finally took it down. But it does get out there, and it does go in. If I was to ever run for political office and ever go back onto somebody's College of Complexes videos, just imagine the field day one of the announcers would have when he sees me say something like, I recommend that the North should separate from the South, which was in a rebuttal I did a number of years ago, and that our gracious David told me, I thought this was settled at Appomattox. Not knowing, but if you take it out of context, a lot of damage could be done. Personally, I'd love to have that fight with the media, but tell them to go blankety blank and take a look at the actual content, but I wouldn't get elected. Anyway, okay. Paul's gonna give a final thing and then we're gonna go into rebuttals.
Yeah. One thing you need to realize, Tim talked about taking something down off the web. It's still there. It's on a server in an index from Google and many of the other search engines. Google has... No. As far as I know, no. Because Google's... I don't know if it's been used by the police or not yet, but I know I've heard of people going back and finding stuff in those indexes. And Once it's on Google, it's there, and it's there forever. I don't know if there's a way of getting it off or not, but it would be difficult to completely erase anything from Google because nothing sits in one place. The simple way of saying what Google does, when you type in something in that line, you're hitting hundreds, if not thousands, of servers at once. And the only true safe device is the unconnected device.
Well, I have another question.
Mike McHugh had a question.
Yeah. I had an answer to that. You can request to remove it from Google's index, but like you said, it gets copied other places, but you can request to remove something from Google index.
Good. Last question, Lana.
Okay, excuse me. Sometimes when I just turn on computer and go just to see Yahoo, it's first, right? Check my email. Very good. So how come sometimes several screens just jump into my computer? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
Screens, and I have to delete one of them?
That's going to be something that we'll have to take offline and take a look at your computer and see what it's doing.
You probably have a virus or some malware.
Yes, malware or a virus or something. We'll have to take a look at that.
Yeah, but when I
Well, Lana, again, you're asking a very specific question about a computer that we could speculate on now, but it's probably malware or something you're doing that's causing a problem. A sticky keyboard, for example, or some other things you can go here. Anyway, it is getting to be time that we need to get off and get into rebuttals.
How many of you of us have rebuttals, some remarks to make, preferably on the subject? One, two, three, four. So you might get inspired on the way. Five. I think that we have enough time to give everybody at least rebuttal. Okay? Starting with L.P. Anderson.
And our boy, Alexander.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming. Few quick comments here. In the electronic age, how many of you are familiar with a book written in 1980 called Brittle Power? Amory and Hunter Lovins out of the Rocky Mountain Institute. How many are familiar with Rocky Mountain Institute? Okay, well, they published a book in 1980 called Brittle Power, and it talked about the first 12 chapters was everything that could go wrong with coal, oil, natural gas, the transmission lines, weather storms, all kinds of things. The last half of that book, the other 12 chapters, was called Designing for Resilience. But they pointed out the nuclear power industry learned a long time ago that as machines become more complex, you can have failures that are unanticipated. And right now, they coined a term called pulse fodder. Everybody knows what cannon fodder is from way back when soldiers were cannon fodder. Well, everything with a microchip in it, even our watches, radios, is pulse fodder to an electromagnetic pulse. And for this reason, I think that essential appliances in a home should not be connected to the internet, and they should not have electronic controls at all. These new Nest thermostats, we've already installed some emergency switches down on the furnace. When it malfunctions upstairs, it's economically unserviceable, and you can't turn your heat on, much less anybody hacking into it and turning the house up to 95. So people go downstairs and switch over to their manual thermostat by cutting the wire upstairs, switch over to the one in the basement so they can turn the heat on. The same goes for all kinds of other things. How many people have seen the movie Dr. Strangelove? There's a classic comment in there where George C. Scott is talking to the president, and he said, well, I see no reason to condemn the whole program for one small slip-up. I know we're only 25 minutes away from World War III, but let's not condemn the whole program for one small slip-up. And that's the philosophy you should look at with every electronic device that you're thinking about connecting to the Wi-Fi, computer access. There's another movie out right now that I would highly recommend. It just hit the theaters. It's called Spotlight, about the year, decades-long cover of the Catholic priest system, the problem with the pedophile priests. That movie talks about, describes how ordinary people will ignore something that's in front of their face. They don't want to think about it until you finally have a big, big problem right in front of you. And if you were going to, you know, debate, there's a big debate going on among certain circles is who has the best way to live. The people that are on Google and up to their eyeballs in electronics, or the Amish that can survive an electromagnetic power surge and keep farming and producing food and everything else. We're headed toward the point where many societies are going to be looking at that particular thing. In 1982, a lot of analysts produced a report saying the world has always produced a handful of crazy people. Until we can figure out how to genetically prevent the birth of crazy people that will use weapons to kill others. Is that, you're laughing because we can't prevent the birth of crazies, Charlie?
No, I pointed to him when you said that.
Well, that's exactly my point. If we can't prevent the birth of a handful of crazies, we have to not give them portable nuclear weapons or portable electronic devices that can allow them to wreak havoc on hundreds or thousands of people at a time. There's a famous, one last thought. Tell me why I have a minute left. There was a famous analyst in Great Britain. I forget his name, but he was interviewed after 1945, I guess it was, about his long career. They said, how did you see the wars coming? He says, when people came to me every year with dire predictions of a war breaking out, I always denied it. I denied it every time. I was only wrong twice. So that's the philosophy you've got. People say, well, these electronic devices will work great until they fail and your basement is flooded, or your house is frozen solid as a brick, or your car runs off the road because some young hacker with no ethics, no morals, no conscience wants to see what they can do, just creating havoc. And that's what we're seeing in the world today. There's a handful of crazy people out there, and the police are doing the best they can in other countries to keep a better handle on it. But we got some big problems, and the solutions are here. Let's work toward it. We'll be talking about solutions all winter long and next spring. As Charlie said, we'll have four different nights talking about Earth Day, an Earth Day month, talking about solutions where the United States can be converted to running on renewables and clean energy by 2030. If we went with what we have now, we could have no coal, no oil, no gas, and no nukes running in this country in 15 years. That's what's possible. But people shake their heads and say, oh, that'll never happen, that'll never happen. And it is happening. There's a rooftop revolution going on, starting in Chicago, and Germany is already years ahead of us. So there's a bunch of good solutions going on. Get Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything, and look at the solutions she gives for helping global warming problems. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. I sell and market Internet of Things. As it turns out, I work for Honeywell and ADT and a couple other companies I represent. And for commercial applications and residential, it works through security platform. I just set up the first marijuana store in Chicago. That's all Internet of Things. So, door locks, security cameras, everything, the whole place. By the way, so if you ever lose power, all security systems, even the Tinkertoy ones you put in your house, we have a battery backup and that will call you to say you lost power. So you'll know. It's kind of a feature that's kind of nice.
security system. Well, no, when there's a loss of power, we'll call you.
Mike's still on.
Yeah, that's all.
Is it on? Okay. All right. So, anyway, I was hoping these guys would talk a little bit more about, you know, how websites can steal your contacts and your personal information covertly, what have you. So maybe they can talk about that a little bit more. And I was going to go to a Twitter class today, but then I came to the conclusion that Twitter is pretty much useless. It's just for blasting by celebrities, their thoughts, which we don't need, or media outlets, unless I'm missing something. It's a one-way conversation, so it's a terrible website. What else do I have to say? That's about it. I think we have a lot more to worry about, like if we have some nut job right-wing Trump president, President Trump, President Trump will keep us in oil wars for decades. So,
that's a bigger one.
So you want us to vote for that woman?
Hillary.
All right,
who's next?
Finally, a topic I know something about. I work for an internet marketing company. I do mainly security and setting up servers. We set up do the security and. You wouldn't believe what they get on that. Everything's anonymized by number, but they pretty much know everything about, you know, which websites you go to, you know, if you got kids, know if you're married, know what you click on the internet. And as far as Internet of Things, I'm just gonna jump around here. As far as Internet of Things, it's they're pushing devices out because it's a hot market. They're not worried about security. So there's all kinds of they basically have no security. I mean, if you want to see, there's a 60-minute segment you can watch online of someone who crashes a car by logging onto it on the internet. They hit the brakes and cause the car to crash. And there were a few other things here. Pretty much there's no privacy online, so you pretty much have to get used to it. Everybody knows everything about you if you're online. It's pretty much pretend you're in public because everything pretty much is public. Everything you put online is going to pretty much stay there forever, and a lot of people will be able to get access to it. Yeah, if you want more information on this, there's plenty of stuff online. Two things I'd recommend: PBS. PBS leaked last year the United States of Secrets, which is about the NSA. And Frontline a few weeks ago did a cyber war threat, did a show on that, which shows just how vulnerable it is. They actually show a power generator that's connected online, where they actually connected to it from online and caused it to literally explode. And power generators, if you'd do that to a real generator, it would take them 6 months to a year to replace it, because you can't just go down to the store and buy one. They're custom built, so you could literally take a city's power offline, they'd be offline 6 months to a year. And they interviewed an executive on there, and he said he was anonymous, of course, because he's afraid if he would show up on camera that they'd try to hack him. He says, we don't know what to do about this. We're vulnerable, we know it, we don't know how to fix it. So hackers are ahead because it's a defensive game. They all they have to do is break in once. We have to defend 100% of the time. So things are going to get worse before they get better.
I wrote my first computer program in 1964. I've only been online since 1993, so I'm a late adopter relative to a lot of the people I know. If anybody has the second issue of Wired magazine, I was crashing with one of the guys whose picture's on that cover. I'm not by any means a player or a heavyweight on the internet, but I do party with some of them. I can't really give an organized response to a couple of loose fistfuls of Sunday supplement clippings that we've had here. So I'll be as organized as I can, but I will be hopscotching a little bit. Miss Manners had one of the definitive comments on email. Supposedly no one reads what you write on a postcard, but you'd be foolish to write anything confidential and mail it on a postcard. One of the most important things that was not mentioned here is cryptography. There are very good, very strong, fairly easy to use cryptographic programs that will make your email fairly unreadable. Maybe the NSA can do it in 10 years, but they won't probably have it much sooner. No secret is permanent. Cryptography. If you're interested, there's a program called Pretty Good Privacy, PGP. So if you Google PGP, you can probably find out what to do with your email. The Internet of Things is an idea. It's not even a product category. It just smells hot, so it's the slogan everybody's going to use this year. We're going to see a wild spike in attention and media coverage and product announcements and investment opportunities, and then it's going to crash, and then the real true potential will simply continue to grow. So we will have a lot of things connected to a lot of other things, but not immediately. It's coming, but it's not going to be this year. Electronic voting machines. There is no reliable electronic voting machine. Any electronic voting machine is probably being used fraudulently. There is no reputable programmer who trusts any electronic voting machine. And backing up the big picture, this stuff is just being invented now. My number one comment on the entire electronic information revolution, it's earlier than you think. We have just barely begun. A historical parallel I study is the printing press. It took 200 years for the printing press to shake out. It took 40 years for somebody to invent page numbers, and you don't have a table of contents or an index without page numbers. So I don't know, you know, Google is trying to index all knowledge, but I'm not sure where that's going to go or what we're going to end up with. But it's earlier than you think. And we have institutional tools which are capable of dealing with many of the problems described here. I think everyone here knows the word and the legal concept, liability. The reason that American charge cards work differently from European charge cards is the liability laws are different. Makes a lot of sense. You don't have to be a techie to see that fits. We need liability for computer security. It doesn't exist. It has to come. That's going to be a political fight. And on the political front, there are two organizations you need to follow. The Electronic Frontier Foundation, EFF, Electronic Frontier Foundation. If you are interested in any of this, that is the place to start. The EFF, the Electronic Frontier Foundation. There is also EPIC, E-P-I-C, the Electronic Privacy, EPIC, E-P-I-C. Electronic Privacy, they're the number two guys. Write them a check. If you really want to keep up with the tech, get their newsletter. It's in English, honest. And incidentally, Google is not watching you. Google is recording you, which is what the government is doing. They don't care what you're doing right now, but if they become interested, they want to know what you have done all your life. It's a little bit different. It's used differently. My time is running out. Two very quick notes. Set your browser to delete all cookies at the end of a session. Cookies are basically how the companies on the other end follow what you've been doing with your browser. They're just little tiny bits of information but they get read over your shoulder and passed around and yada yada. Your browser, somewhere in the settings, you can set it to simply delete all cookies every time you close the program, whether it's Internet Explorer or Firefox or Chrome, whatever browser you use. And finally, the Onion Router Tor, which is way cool, but is heavier duty than a lot of people need. Tor was invented by our very own spooks, so that people in places like Iran and China can surf without disappearing. And it's very amusing that now Tor is kind of the big gateway to what's called the Darknet, which is kind of the private underbelly of the internet, which is used for many, many, many private purposes, also just generally for privacy. And finally, if Google records everything, there is a search engine which does basically what Google does when you're looking stuff up, but it doesn't record anything. And the name of that one is DuckDuckGo, like two birds, DuckDuckGo. And I hope I haven't used any words that you either didn't know or that I didn't define, which unfortunately sets me apart from several of the other speakers also.
Next, please.
Hi, I'm Larry. I wanted to address a few things. One is with Twitter. The good aspect about Twitter is you can complain about a company without directly writing a letter to that company, and all the people on Twitter will see your comments and see that that corporation needs to be corrected, and the corporation just actually might do something about it. That's one good aspect about Twitter. In terms of the cloud, I'm skeptical about how good the cloud can be because of censorship. Imagine, you know, like if each one of us downloaded a book on our own computer, that's a lot of data. So the cloud carries that book up in the cloud, and each one of us just contacts the book without it being downloaded on our separate computers. So if the government wants to censorship that book and take it down off the cloud, and we don't have it, a copy of that book on our own hard drives, that book is just turned into dust. It's an invisible, lost knowledge. And the last thought is just in terms of the Edward Snowden and Julian Assange and WikiLeaks, we have to just hand it to these whistleblowers. They just really let us know just that tip of the iceberg and all that's out there.
Hello. Just a quick thing about Twitter. It is not a one-way conversation, and it's not just for celebrities.
Yeah.
Celebrities do use it. It is like Facebook and Instagram, but you get to have an actual conversation with people. So, like, say for instance, if you want to find out if your favorite movie actor or actress has a Twitter, you search the person, you can tweet the person or private message the person. So you can actually have an actual conversation like you and me are having right now. And about what I said earlier, you can get security on your phone. If you go on the Google Play Store or iTunes, I don't know if Apple has it yet, but I know on Google Play you can search security software and it'll come up with a whole mess of security software that you can put on your phone. I would recommend 360 degree security. It has worked with my phone. But if you have a lot of personal information like photos or something that you don't want to delete, I wouldn't do it because it will delete all your photos and all your music if you don't uncheck it. So that's all I have to say about that.
A lot of what we've done on this internet. Is it on?
You gotta talk closer.
Yeah,
that's
what it's
now is it working?
Yeah.
There you go.
I guess I wasn't talking into it. But we have a problem with, now I forgot what I wanted to say. But anyway, the internet that you've been brought up tonight, we've talked a lot about munitions, what we're doing, what we're not doing. But we haven't looked at the overview. Our computers are now being produced in other countries. None of our computers are produced in this country. Apple produces everything in China. They don't produce anything here. We've lost thousands of jobs since. Also, the computer, the new revolution of the computer has changed the way we buy things. We've lost a lot of jobs in stores. We buy everything on the internet. A lot of things are being bought there, so we're losing jobs that way. Since the Industrial Revolution, machines replace people. Machines don't pay taxes. That's been going on since we know when. One of the things we have to worry about is what we've done is we've allowed corporations to get bigger than countries, and that is not a good thing. We've got a situation in our country where we have the best Congress money can buy. That's one of our problems. Corporations are controlling the Congress, and that is not a good thing. And what is the definition of fascism? That is corporations control the government. Remember that. And we need to do something about it. We need to get Congress maybe to act in its own self-interest, to instruct the Federal Communications Commission to require the media to provide sufficient free airtime. Then people would represent people. They would represent the people that elect them as opposed to representing the people buying their vote in Washington. Once you did that, then you could pass legislation to put tariffs on corporations so you could create jobs here. Then you might also think about shortening the workday. We need jobs in this country. That's one way of doing it. Thank you.
Okay, everybody.
Hello. Hope you enjoy your mission. Hey, Susan, good to see you.
Yay, Charlie.
Tom and Drew. All right, I'll be eclectic because each of us thank our speakers again. Very informative. That spooky guy scared me, man. That one guy with the heavy eyebrows. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I'm not terribly high tech. I'm usually 18 months behind the industry, which is a generation. Isn't it 12, 18 months now, or is it drawn down at all?
Doubling of processing power every 18 months is what Moore's Law is.
Yeah. I did speak here. We're talking a lot. You gave it a fancy term here. What did you call it? All tools, or what was the thing for all the stuff?
Internet of Things.
I spoke about that. I gave the speech on 100 gadgets that had transformed our lives, and the one that came to mind, one of those gadgets was. I think maybe it was the one that started all of this, was the Zenith Television Company. They had this thing where you could sit in your chair and change the channels. My uncle had one of those. They ran an electronics business. But that seemed to be a feature. Thinking of other things, people that you've said it any number of times here, there's no expectation of privacy. By the way, there's only an expression of privacy implied implication of privacy in the Constitution, despite what's in there. And I like people who don't use their name on there as their internet name, and you get crazy things like Wolf Girl or something like this. I think this is going to keep you secret. You know, no one will figure out. If you find out who you are, they'll be deceived and befuddled by this secret code name that you use, you know. I don't know, but for some reason I was thinking about this. And early in the days, and I was employed in a federal government agency, and I had a number of young clerks, and we were kind of on the cutting edge of some of this stuff. We We actually had the first PC in the agency that I work with, the division. But at the time, I was thinking they were very much afraid of people downloading software for security reasons. But when they did a sweep and they came to my unit, we had I still remember, I had actually done some work on this and some effort. I even went through Chinatown so I could find something and added some Chinese software. I was going to learn how to read Chinese. And the government investigators came by wondering what all this was. I said, oh, that's just Paydoc, you know. Don't worry about it. Last of all, there was a thing like, and Andy hit on it a little bit, I think you missed the point, has in fact all of this technology brought improvement in our lives. If you're a captured piece to one of these devices, as I ride public transit, I understand now there actually is an assertion that people are parking their cars, and this is the latest one, this has been in the news and the literature. People are in fact not using their automobiles because it does not enable them to use their little devices. And they are taking public transportation because they can use this. I'm serious. Now it could be that they are a second office or you can get an additional hour in, but there are people who they believe a certain percentage of people are abandoning their automobiles and using public transit. And last of all, though, have these gadgets in fact improve our lives? In some instances, I often think about it because I like the graphic arts, and I often think, well, how did we do it back then? We used to make flyers and illustrations and files and. And we managed to live and succeed, and I don't know, it was such a detrimental period of time, the dark ages of sort. Is this high tech really brought us? It's been covered in the literature and some of the media and the movies, you know. He talked about the Amish and seemed to get along perfectly well without any of it whatsoever. And seem to have full, complete lives. Do they facilitate? Certainly, all of this facilitates communication. Now, is that worthwhile communication, or is that what I call gibberosity? You know? Oh, I see people making telephone calls. Well, I just got off the bus.
Yeah.
Or I see this in transit terminal. Or, they're not imparting any real useful information or expecting the other person to do something. It's just like, it's time to make a call without any particular content message or response expected by the party on the other side, you know. But anyhow, it was kind of enjoyable. Thank you guys for putting it together. I enjoyed it. Thank you. You said it turned you off. Thank you for the signal. Like, get out of here.
All right, who's next?
We're getting a cab.
David Zucker.
Do you have a car?
I want to thank our speakers for a very interesting
car.
Closer to the microphone.
I want to thank our speakers for a very interesting and very timely talk. First of all, the Supreme Court in 1965 did rule in Griswold versus the state of Connecticut that there is a right to privacy in the Constitution. Second of all, I heard it said tonight that paper ballots are the gold standard, they can't be altered, etc. Well, folks, I've lived in Chicago all my life, since the 1950s. And you folks don't seem to understand what an enterprising precinct captain can do with a paper ballot. That's why we went to mechanical voting machines back in the 50s. And it was still possible to mess with those. So there is no real foolproof way, unfortunately, to guarantee the sanctity of the vote. It would be nice if there were, but there, unfortunately, is not. Finally, I cracked an in-joke earlier with Tim, and it perhaps should be explained. In the 1960s, a series of three novels came out about Colossus, the Forman Project. The made-for-TV movie was based, I believe, on the first one. And essentially what happens in there, and I'll try and make this brief so I don't have to rehash the whole thing. A scientist named Dr. Charles Forman, who was played in the movie by Eric Braeden, develops for the U.S. government a computer system that will take over the nation's nuclear missiles so that human error won't be responsible for setting them off. The Soviet Union, at the same time, suddenly develops its own similar system called Guardian. Then, before the Americans or the Soviets realize what's happening, when the two systems come online, they suddenly start talking to one another and merge into a single system called World Control. And yeah, this thing takes over the world. The U.S. and Soviet governments now have to do what World Control tells them to do. Pretty scary.
Yes.
Yep. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else?
You got to be low tech, man.
All right, we got.
No one else? Yeah. Well, in that case, we will have to hear from our speakers.
Unless Brian has the word out.
No, I don't have any rebuttals to make. I'm so ignorant about the internet and even email that I would not enlighten anyone. Which of you is going to be first?
No, first, Paul. Including remarks.
Paul Rescino. I would like to refer to what the gentleman said about encryption. I will tell you something, and it may surprise you. It is safer to use your credit card on a secure, encrypted website than it is for you to pick up the phone, make a phone call, and give it over your phone. For someone to tap your phone, all they have to do is shimmy up your phone pole, clip onto your phone line, and they can hear everything you're saying. There is no code encoding or encryption or anything. And as the gentleman said, if it is encrypted, it's very difficult to get. Not only that, when information is sent across the internet, it's broken down into little pieces. So not the whole, everything's going to go in one message. It's going to go in a bunch of different little messages that may not follow the same route through the internet. And also, getting what's called a sniffer, which is what you use for reading what's going across the internet, is very expensive and even more difficult to get into place.
All the employers have them.
So, as I said before, the only truly safe device is the unconnected device, and that's always been the case. But if you use some common sense and keep yourself protected, you know, this almost sounds like sex. You know? Use some common sense and keep yourself protected, you should be okay. And if you notice on your computer and anything that just doesn't look right, that's when you update your security software and run a full scan and find what's there.
Paul, why don't you tell them what you normally do on a monthly basis for when you do maintenance and stuff?
When I do maintenance for a client, I go in, the first thing I do is make sure Microsoft Windows is up to date, all the updates. I run a program called CCleaner, which cleans up files that aren't needed and also does some repairs on the registry. And then I do a defragmentation of the hard drive, and I run a program called Malware Bytes, just to look and see if there's anything there, just in case. You know, a lot of things are there. You can have a zombie on your computer and not know it until it's activated. That's why I also suggest every year or two you completely reinstall your computer, because that's the only way to really get rid of everything.
Zombies.
All right.
Just
just sit right back and you'll hear a tale about my virtual trip. It started on this IBM with a simple little click. I went to surf the internet, assuming it's secure. But all of a sudden I found that world of the Onion router. My God, the illegal activity, over two-thirds you can't see. Over two-thirds that are hidden from me on this internet. No, but anyway, you get the idea. Oh my God, I'm trapped on the internet. Anyway, I'd like to thank you, all of you again, for listening to another presentation from the College of Complexes. Me and Paul are both Toastmasters, so we would welcome any feedback you may have about our presentation style or anything that you may want to do with us. I appreciate you listening. I appreciate all of you, again, just coming and letting us rant for a couple of hours. We hope you learned something, and I'll have Brown close us out.
All right. Thank you. Thank you both. Paul, Tim, we hope to hear from you again, and I know I want to see you all as soon as you can get yourselves back here. So, and some of you have come a ways to get here, so I'm thankful for that. And this is that season.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I hope that you get home safely and come back to us smiling.